Today, we stand on the verge of a scientific revolution. A revolution as important as the discovery of electricity, the flight of the Wright brothers, and even the development of nuclear fission, that is the bomb, the atom bomb. And I can't wait to tell you about it. But first, I'd like to tell you a story. And since it's close to Halloween, it's going to be a ghost story. I have many nieces and nephews, and they love to come visit me in San Francisco. They love to come out on the old trains and go out to the beach and play in the sand. Then they like to come back to my place and eat a giant stack of blueberry pancakes. It can be really chaotic at times, but it's also been a lot of fun to watch their personalities blossom and their intelligence emerge. Now, some of you may know that San Francisco has recently approved the use of self-driving cars on our streets. And a few weeks ago, my 8-year-old niece came to visit me, and she saw one of these self-driving cars. And she thought that was just the coolest thing in the world. And then later, about 10:30 p.m. that night, I got a voice memo on Messenger Kids. She was very concerned. She was very concerned, and she wanted me to tell you something. She was concerned that, by the way, this is a true story, by the way. She was very concerned that if you come to San Francisco and you see a self-driving car, you might think it's being driven by a ghost. And you shouldn't worry. It's not being driven by a ghost. It's just AI. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining me today. Again, I'm Dr. Charles H. Martin. I'm a scientist, inventor, and entrepreneur. And I'd like you to join me as we delve into the world of artificial intelligence. Now, what do I mean by artificial intelligence? How many of you here have used ChatGPT? I mean, it's amazing, isn't it? It's just incredible. Okay, sometimes it makes mistakes and sometimes it makes stuff up. Technically, we say that it hallucinates. And yet still, it displays amazing, complex cognitive abilities. The abilities previously only ascribed to young children. And yet, a lot of people seem to be afraid of AI. And why is that? I mean, maybe some people think it's going to start a nuclear war. If you run a business, maybe you think ChatGPT is going to mount a hostile takeover. You know, there could be some reason to be afraid of AI, but I think the real reason that people are afraid is the same reason we're afraid of so many other things. We just don't understand why it works. See, engineers at companies like Google and OpenAI and other big tech companies, they've discovered how to emulate human intelligence in software. They call this deep learning, but their understanding of it isn't so deep. The reason it's called deep learning is because these AI models are built like a stack of layers, much like a stack of pancakes. Some of these models have up to 1,000 layers in them. And that's a lot of pancakes. The thing is, though, engineers have found when you stack the models up like this, they seem to perform really well. The thing is, they have no idea why it performs so well. So this brings us to a big question. Is ChatGPT really intelligent? Is it this artificial general intelligence that we've dreamed about for 50 years and that we've witnessed and read about in movies and TV shows and comic books? Or is it just some stochastic parrot mimicking our speech but with no real understanding? That is some form of artificial general intelligence emerging in these systems? Or is it just hype, just another tech fad? Now, I don't think it's a fad. I'm all in. And I think after today, you will be too. And to convince you, I'd like to tell you a little history of the subject of AI. See, about 50 years ago, mathematicians and theoretical chemists and physicists were studying neurons, the cells in our brain, and how they communicate with each other. The way they work is that neurons send electrical signals to each other, pulses. We say that neurons that fire together wire together. Now, our brain has billions and billions of neurons. So that's a very complex wiring. And to understand this, we need a complex theory. So enter theoretical physics. In 1997, the physicist Perbach, with two of his postdoctoral students, published a groundbreaking paper on a new concept called self-organized criticality. They were trying to understand how the open question of how order emerges from disorder. Like kids playing at the beach, they were taking sand piles and they were stacking them up one grain at a time and watching them collapse over and over. And from this, they discovered some amazing physics. They discovered that many complex systems, like sand piles and earthquakes, even stock market crashes, all display a remarkable similarity. These systems all self-organize around a critical point, a point of balance between order and chaos. Now, this idea exploded on the scene like an avalanche. It was really the theme of the decade, but it wasn't without controversy. There were skeptics. There always are skeptics when new science is discovered. Unfortunately, in 2001, Perbach died. And about the same time, AI research died too. See, this was at a time when the Cold War had just ended, and academic funding for many areas of research dried up. We never got the nuclear winter that we were warned about, but we did get the AI winter. Research just ended, for the most part. And like many of my colleagues, I left academics. I went to Silicon Valley and worked as a software engineer. I worked as a quant on Wall Street for a while, even trying to predict when the stock market will crash. And then, about 10 years ago, AI reemerged on the tech scene. And for me, a new opportunity emerged. Emerged to, once again, try to understand who and what we really are and how we're connected to the physical universe. So I cracked the books. I started researching what's going on. I started publishing some papers with an old friend and of mine who's a faculty member at UC Berkeley. But also at the time, other AI researchers were putting their models on the internet. So I began pulling these models down and peering inside them. I began peering inside the layers of these models, inside that stack of pancakes, and I discovered something extraordinary. All of these deep learning models, when they're trained really well and they perform really well, they all display the same signatures of emergence that we see in other complex systems, like avalanches, like earthquakes, like when the stock market crashes. It turns out that our artificial neural networks, these software systems of symbolic brain cells, all display the telltale signs of emergence. Now today there's a scientific theory. It's called the critical brain hypothesis. And it posits that when the neurons in our brain send signals to each other, that these neurons coalesce into avalanches of activity, echoing the rhythms of emergent criticality that we see across the physical universe. And in my research, I've discovered that inside the layers of these deep neural networks, they display the exact same signatures. So it appears that at its core, AI is not just data and statistics, as some people would say. But it's not data on Star Trek either, or Brainiac, or the Terminator, at least not yet. So what are these amazing emerging properties we talk about? Cognitive scientists have run tests on ChatGPT over time as it's gotten better and better. And what they've discovered is that today, GPT-4 can pass these cognitive tests at the same level of performance as my 8-year-old niece. Now, that is just astounding. And yet, some of you may have chatted with ChatGPT and you may find that you don't realize, if this thing is so smart, why does it make stuff up? Why doesn't it give me factual answers all the time? Well, in my own research, I've also found that when these models get bigger and they perform better and they're trained on larger data sets, the signals of emergence get stronger. But as these signals of emergence get stronger, the model also is better at BSing you. It's astounding. It's like a child who is very clever and precocious, and has a good memory, but just makes stuff up once in a while. This is not a bug. This is a feature. In fact, it's one of the most interesting properties these models have. Which leads to this question, is there a ghost in the machine? Well, in a sense, yes, the ghost is its own daydreams, its own artificial imagination. So when we think about AI, it's not Data on Star Trek, and it's not the Terminator. And in fact, I would argue that when artificial general intelligence arrives, it may not look anything the way our own intelligence works. Think about how we learned to fly. For centuries, we strapped wings onto our backs and jumped off of cliffs. But eventually, we learned the scientific principles of lift and drag. And now we can build airplanes and rockets. We've even gone to the moon. No one would say that an airplane doesn't know how to fly, simply because it doesn't fly like a bird. So as we stand on the precipice of a new era in artificial intelligence, a question beckons. Are we going to fall off the ledge? Is AI going to take our jobs? Is it going to start new wars? Is there going to be an AI apocalypse? I don't think so. See, I think that even when AI comes, you will still fly the plane. AI will just be your co-pilot. So, no, I don't think an AI apocalypse is coming. I think the future is much brighter. And the reason is because we can understand how AI works. And if we understand how AI works, we can do amazing things. Today, we stand at the nexus of an extraordinary endeavor, where peering into the layers of these deep learning models has not only taught us something about technology, but has unveiled new layers of our own intelligence. The signatures of criticality are emerging in these models. And as we develop this newfound scientific understanding of how AI works, we can build a better future for us and for our children. Thank you.